Our next conversation is around shaping fintech regulations and lessons from the sandboxes, which is obviously, without the proper regulation, it's very difficult to innovate and drive new financial services, technology, and innovation. So I'd like to welcome to the stage David Parker, the Executive Director of Financial Services, Bahrain Economic Development Board, Christopher Q. Smith, Head of Fintech Strategy, Financial Services Regulatory Authority, Dubai, ADGM, Peter Smith, Managing Director, Head of Policy and Strategy for DFSA, and our moderator, Gayla Boscovich, Head of Fintech and RegTech Partnerships, as well as FemTech Global. Welcome.
You had the misfortune of hearing from me before. You're getting a repeat, so my apologies. If you were in the session this morning, you know the fascination with regulation, or you I expressed it with sincere passion. And frankly, I think what is actually most interesting is regulation is driving innovation. And that is a thesis that I maintain from the get-go. Regulation in my book is the sexiest thing ever. Why? Because we actually create a level playing field for everyone, and that means that we're forced to find our competitive advantage differently. That because we're all under the same structure, true innovation is finding what you do differently and executing it distinctly well, and creating a competitive advantage that your other affiliates and partners or part of the ecosystem cannot replicate. And therefore, you're actually driving value-added services. So the interesting thing about this is regulation is getting a lot of coverage in the past few, maybe 2 years. RegTech has become a thing. Supervisory tech has become a thing. And now this is really where we start to look, at least from a markets perspective, of how do we differentiate what we're going to do as an institution. And these gentlemen next to me, if you remember from the slide before, are all part of the regulatory ecosystem. And I would like today to actually explore some of the best practices that you see here in the region, but also what the region can learn from elsewhere, from other parts of the world. Some of you have come from other regulatory systems, and how do you bring that insight from those who have experimented more into the GCC? And how do we actually create a very proactive, sustainable regulatory environment that allows for this competitive advantage to arise and take advantage of the technologies that are here for us now. So with that in mind, that's the context of this. Maybe we can take a minute for you to give a little bit of each of your backgrounds, where you came from, and what you're currently doing. So Chris, do you want to kick it off?
So thanks very much to Arabnet for having us here today. Pleasure to see Gayla, David, and Peter again. So I work in fintech now, as my title implies, but actually I started off as a derivatives lawyer working in private practice in a London law firm. And I guess after the crisis, derivatives markets were not a growing market, much the opposite. And I decided I needed to broaden out and do something that was much more vibrant. And so therefore I started to move into fintech more and more. Just before arriving here in the UAE, I worked at the UK's Financial Conduct Authority, and I set up their regulatory sandbox and also wrote their discussion papers as regards to blockchain technology. Very, very happy to be here now, working for the Abu Dhabi Global Market, the regulator there. We have a variety of fintech initiatives. Two in particular, as a highlight, we have our own regulatory sandbox, the Reg Lab, which is still open for applications up to the 10th of May. Very much would welcome any more applications that we've had.
No pitching. Okay, this is not a sales opportunity.
One more pitch.
Later? Maybe later?
Okay, maybe later.
If you're good, I'll let you.
Okay, fine.
All right. David, give us a little background.
Thank you. Well, unlike these gentlemen either side of me, I'm not actually a regulator. I'm with the Economic Development Board for Bahrain, and I always say that the Economic Development Board for Bahrain, we do nothing but everything. So we're not a regulator, we're not a startup, we're not a bank, we're not an investor, but we work with all of those different players to pull the ecosystem together The intention being that our ecosystem develops and accelerates quicker than might be the case without that intervention from the EDB. So we have an outstanding relationship with the Central Bank of Bahrain. Again, forgive me if it sounds like a pitch, but I personally think that the CBB is one of the leading regulators in the world, one of the most respected regulators in the world, and has been for many, many decades. But there's a recognition that for our industry in Bahrain to survive moving forward, we have to embrace the digital agenda. And to embrace the digital agenda, we have to attract more innovators to Bahrain, and to attract more innovators to Bahrain, we have to have an innovation-friendly regulatory environment. So, a slightly different tack to your point earlier, you talked about regulation driving innovation. I think from a Bahrain perspective, we see regulation as creating an innovation-friendly environment, and then it's the entrepreneurs and the banks that will actually drive the actual innovation on the back.
Let's actually reframe that. So if it's not regulation, it's policy.
True.
And frankly, innovation is a mindset, not a thing we do. It's how we think about it. The small premise of we have to decide what we are before we can act on it, and therefore we have integrity. But if we act without knowing what we are, we're up for compromise each and every time. So policy-driven push towards a different mindset that really does take into consideration multiple facets of an ecosystem to innovate. Peter.
Yeah, I'm a long-time regulator, clearly the longest-serving regulator on the panel, as you can see, because I'm wearing a suit and Chris isn't. I was advised to take my tie off beforehand, but never mind. I think what you've said is absolutely right. The public policy argument here is about how do we create the right conditions in which innovation can thrive. That's what all three of us are trying to do. We're sitting here in Dubai. We've got the UAE National Innovation Strategy, which was launched in 2014. We've got various Dubai initiatives. Other people in the room can list them more than I can, but you know, the Dubai 2021 plan, Smart Dubai, and so on. So, you know, innovation is very much in the lifeblood of Dubai, and what we're trying to do in the DIFC, as you've heard from Raja in the previous session, Raja Al-Mazrui and the FinTech Hive, what we're trying to do is create an environment in which innovation can thrive. Now, obviously, there are lots of other people here today at this event talking about things other than financial services, but for us, the focus is on FinTech and on RegTech. I don't like supervisory tech, because soup tech always reminds me a bit it sounds a bit like a can of Heinz. Okay, so maybe we can continue with the food analogies as we go through our session this morning.
Okay, all right.
But you know, I think the environment that you're trying to create is one in which different sorts of innovators, that whether that's an existing large bank with a license that wants to do something different, whether that's a startup with two people and the proverbial dog, we want all of them to be able to come to our environment, and indeed in Bahrain, and indeed in Abu Dhabi, and find conditions in which they can do things that are a benefit to society more broadly.
Well, let's actually talk about that notion of collaboration. So a few years ago, it was FinTech is going to eat the bank's lunch. It's very combative. It was all about competition. The tone has fundamentally changed. And when we start to incorporate the other pillar, not just the technology and the financial institutions, but those that regulate them or those that set the policy, that triangle now becomes a fundamentally different dynamic. And it does require a certain element of collaboration. What are some of the things that you're seeing now that are really starting to move the needle in the ecosystem, and you're starting to see things be deployed or be put into delivery that fundamentally produce a result? What are some of those examples that you're seeing coming through some of the sandboxes?
Again, I'll come at this from a regulatory perspective, because we're on a regulatory panel, and with respect to the gentleman either side of me, I guess regulators are a bit like calamari, aren't they? You know, you either love them or hate them. But I think from the perspective of Bahrain, what we're trying to do with the central bank is move towards a much more approachable regulator. So the regulator, Central Bank of Bahrain, for example, has a desk in FinTech Bay, which is a dedicated space for FinTech. So instead of booking an appointment to go to see the central bank, perhaps 1 month in advance, going through security, getting escorted by security to a boardroom, sat there being grilled by 15 regulators, you know, sit and have a cup of coffee in FinTech Bay with the regulator, talk about your idea and get an informed, some informed feedback on how that might best work. And I think by bringing the regulator out of the central bank and engaging them more with the startups and the banks as far as innovation is concerned, what we've also seen is them now start to reach out to other regulators. I think the very first meeting of the fintech regulators, Chris, from across the region took place just a couple of weeks ago. There's an MOU that we developed with Abu Dhabi Global Markets at the beginning of this year. We're actively engaged with the Saudi Arabia Monetary Authority, and of course they've launched FinTech Saudi this week. Dubai, you know, goes without saying, as such an important player within this space, is another location. So we're looking to collaborate with all of the other regulators across the region.
Thanks. To add to that, there's a lot of different levels of collaboration, right? So you've got the intergovernmental collaboration, and in the region, so there was, as David was mentioning earlier on, there was recently a GCC FinTech working group of the regulators in the GCC. End of last year, ADGM hosted a regulated roundtable specifically on FinTech as well, at which the FSA and Central Bank of Bahrain, that was great to have them. We have also had relationships with international regulators like Hong Kong, Singapore, Australia, Canada, etc. Because for a lot of FinTechs, and to Gayla's point earlier on around operational costs being really, really low, the name of the game is about scalability, right? You have to be able, as a FinTech, to be able to move cross-border as quickly and as efficiently as possible. So the government-to-government relationships are really important. Then you look at it sort of next level down, think about the government-to-institutional-industry and startups relationship. Again, to David's point, that is absolutely crucial. We adopt, taking inspiration from the UK FCA, for example, we do adopt very much an open door policy to dealing with startups, but we also collaborate very closely with institutions. So we launched an eKYC utility project with six of the largest financial institutions in the country about 2 months ago, and that's, and we're really looking forward to the outcome of that. So when you think about collaboration, we always want to look at every possible layer that we can, because without absolutely everyone talking to everyone else, it's going to be very difficult to try and develop any sort of innovative product.
But this is an interesting thing coming from the FCA. You've seen this, and you helped set up the sandbox. The sandbox has fintechs going through cohorts, ten at a time, looking at playing with the data sets, also ring fencing some of the testing. For those who aren't familiar with the sandbox, maybe you can give us a really quick definition of one level set.
Yeah, so I guess the FCA and also here in AGM, we say it's essentially a safe space for people to test innovative products in the market live with real clients, but under very close supervision by the regulator. And so, you know, we all have weekly, very regular meetings and calls with these companies, because they're trying to bring something that's of real value and really innovative to the market for the benefit of the participants in it.
So the first, this is the first time there are five banks in the current UK FCA cohort, which is quite interesting. When you talk about what a sandbox has traditionally looked like, banks have sandboxes where they do their testing environment anyway. But for them to now play in that space and actually be very closely watched, guided, coached, in conjunction with the rest of the participants in that cohort, as well as the regulatory body, it's quite a different way of looking at it, is inviting institution and competition into the same place to actually find collaboration. And I think perhaps that's probably the most essential thing I think we all sort of have seen coming from different markets, is that collaboration and informality, interestingly enough, as David, you mentioned, the informal nature of the relationships that are now being built, where it is no longer about status, it is no longer about title and position, it is actually about my ability to access the people that have that intelligence or that insight, and bringing down the walls of a formal structure, making it very friendly. The fact that I'm talking to these gentlemen is probably an absolute astounding feat, because informal, crude, rude, socially unacceptable, and they're all booted and suited, and yet here I am, and I get to ask you questions.
But it's a different, you said it, it's a different form of collaboration. the sandbox idea, whatever you call it, and everyone has different labels for them, is simply a way of bringing interested parties together, as with some of the accelerator programs that you see. And we bring together regulatory expertise, we bring together innovation, we bring together people who have problems to solve, which is more likely to be an incumbent firm, whether that be a bank or some other large insurer or similar type of firm. And we try and bring expertise together. The startups learn from the regulator about what the regulatory environment is. They learn from the incumbent firms what the reality is of doing business in whatever area it is that they're talking about. We learn what the business models are, and we can try and work out whether we actually can regulate them or not. The incumbent firms get a big innovation, whacking great injection in the arm, which helps them. It's interesting you were talking in the Bahrain context about splitting or having a separate office for the central bank staff down in FinTech Bay. Because I think that's what you see the large firms doing. They're splitting off their innovation arms from their main operations because they don't believe that within the cultures that they have, they can successfully innovate in the status quo. So you've got to find different ways of bringing people together. You know, there's some great examples from the UK of large banks, you know, taking 1,000 staff to innovate and moving them somewhere else in the country because leaving them in the head office isn't going to work. But it is really, all, as you're saying, all about finding different ways of bringing people together.
Well, let's talk about the accelerator culture here. Because Startup Bootcamp, for example, is 26 programs globally. And each program has to adapt to the unique regional culture. And I think we need to be incredibly honest with ourselves. There are aspects of cultures that enable and hinder. Everywhere you go, there's always going to be a list of enablers and a list of shackles. What are some of the things that you see as really conducive here in this market, and some of the cultural changes that you might invite into the market to make it a little bit faster, a little bit easier? What have you observed in your time here?
So on the point in terms of inviting cultural changes into the market, this has been a really integral part of our strategy from a Bahrain perspective for two reasons. One, we're a tiny country. I mean, we're a total population of 1.4 million. And when you're a population of 1.4 million, you have to think globally. You know, our market is too small. So we've not just looked at collaborations regionally, but we've looked internationally. We've developed very strong links with London through Innovate Finance, and we've looked at the FCA model quite closely. We've developed good links with Singapore and the Monetary Authority of Singapore, and in fact it was the FinTech Consortium based out of Singapore that we appointed to run FinTech Bay, because we did an international search to find the right expertise and almost take advantage of the fact that we're late adopters. When I relocated to the Gulf in 2016, I felt it was probably about 5 years behind London, but the potential here was huge. So rather than spend 5 years catching up, I thought let's learn from London, let's adopt that good practice quickly, and get on with it. So we will always look towards other international markets. And where it starts to get really exciting was I was in London last in March. I think the FSA were there as well. There was the inaugural meeting of the global sandbox, or should I say, before everybody gets really excited, proposed global sandbox, because I'm sure there's a lot of work to be done to make it a reality. But the thinking behind the FCA, very much ahead of the game again, was yes, you can enter the FCA sandbox in London, but only operate in the UK. Yes, you can enter the sandbox in Bahrain, but only operate within Bahrain. Wouldn't it be exciting if some of these regulators internationally came together and allowed companies to test ideas across multiple markets, for example? So I think you're right, embracing that international culture will always be an integral part of our strategy. Sorry, Chris. Yeah.
So I guess for me, one of the biggest things about this region is just how open the regulators and the governments are, right, to innovation and fintech. So we have, you know, DFSA, ADGM, Bahrain Central Bank and Economic Development Board, all very much, very keen to get their hands dirty in terms of fintech understanding business models, teaching ourselves about the market, but also educating those in the market. So that openness is really good. I think that as David was saying, you know, some of the institutions here, they're still very much in a learning process in terms of how to deal with these startups. And I remember in the UK, you know, say 6-7 years ago, a lot of the banks really struggled in the UK. How on earth do I talk to this 25-year-old in jeans? Like, what do I do with him?
You don't, by the way.
Well, not anymore.
Exactly.
But you know, but interestingly, some of the best startups actually are people run by people in their 40s. But
actually, just to get the small statistic, is that 70% of the entrepreneurs that go through startup bootcamp are industry and are over the age of 40.
Yep.
And one of those things is, let's be honest about the hard work it actually takes to learn the industry. That's also something I think is quite interesting, is the maturity of people at the table. There is something a little bit different about the level of conversation now, understanding that I have a background in finance, I'm looking at this business model differently, I am engaged in new deep tech, and I'm going to sit down with my former peers and actually help them understand the gap that I was able to identify, and we have a different conversation. I work with a lot of entrepreneurs day in and day out, and I do deal with the youngsters. I don't remember ever being young, but apparently that happens, and at 25, 20, at 45, I still think I know everything. But it is interesting, the nature of the conversation. There's a maturity of it. Now, I want to observe, and I want to make the observation that all of us are not from the region originally. And yet, we are here speaking as though we have some insight and authority on that. That has to be acknowledged, that just on stage there's a little bit of that gap. How do we explain it? How do we reconcile it? And is that something that we should be concerned with just by the nature of who's on stage speaking about the market?
That's a very, very good point. You know, I'd like to point out that in ADGM, the head of our regulatory laboratory, Vishal, who I know you know very well, he was born and raised here in the UAE. And so he knows the market remarkably well. When I first, in fact, now still, I still talk to him, like, how on earth does this work here in the UAE? You know, what should I watch out for? What's good? You know. Also, you know, we have a lot of extraordinarily talented Emirati colleagues. We have an associate director of anti-money laundering. And you know, we were walking him through some of the things that we're working on. And he goes, "Oh yeah, I met this AI solution the other day. Maybe we should think about using that ourselves." You know, and he's thinking very innovatively about his own job and supervising the markets for AML purposes. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think that having a really good mix of team. So yes, absolutely. I've only been in the region for 8 months, but we have fantastic colleagues like Vishal, like Mohammed Jawed Shallow in anti-money laundering. And I think that having the right mix of staff really helps to address some of the things you, well, as a foreigner, you have to get used to when you first arrive.
I think it's a combination of the two. If you take the makeup of the FinTech Bay board as an example, so FinTech Bay is chaired by Khaled Al-Rumehi, who's also the CEO of the Economic Development Board, and is obviously a Bahraini. The CEO of FinTech Bay, Khalid Saad, is a Bahraini. But then you have people on that board, myself, I'm from the UK, you have Gerben Visa from Singapore, you have Maysan Al-Maskati, who's actually from Bahrain, but now operates out of the United States. And we just appointed a new board member from the UAE to bring in that regional perspective as well. So I think it's the balance between the two, that local know-how, that local talent, that local ownership, if you like, blended with people that can come in and bring in an international perspective as well.
Yeah, I think it is a global business. After all, FinTech is, for the reasons that have already been discussed, something that has fewer borders than many conventional aspects of financial services. So you need people who can deal with that. We, as our colleagues in Abu Dhabi, we have roughly between a quarter and a third of our staff are Emirati. One of them is in the room today, but I'm not going to embarrass them by pointing them out. Again, you know, for us, the DFSA, if I can just speak more generally for a moment, we have a Tomorrow's Regulatory Leaders program, which is essentially our graduate program. We take talented Emiratis from university, and we try and turn them into high-quality regulators, and thus far that's been a hugely successful program for us. We bring in international expertise, and it's our job to pass that on to Emirati nationals and other and people from elsewhere in the Gulf who are working in our organisation. That's a key part of our job. But the startups that we deal with aren't just owned and run by Emiratis or indeed people from Saudi. That, you know, I'm sure we can all list an absolute atlas of places that people who want to do business in the in our reg labs, in our sandboxes want. You know, they're from everywhere. You know, you could probably, you know, get a map of the world up there, throw darts at it, and you say, oh yeah, we've got someone from there, we've got someone from there, Chris has got someone from there, David's got someone from there.
Well, it's that notion of act local but think global. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Speaking of sandboxes, I believe there's a little bit of an announcement today about a new sandbox for new technology. Or there's a new program on ICO and crypto that someone has announced, if you haven't heard. ADGM? I think that's your cue, Chris.
Okay, hi. So
you
yes.
can talk now.
Can I? Yes. Okay, good. Right. So I'm very, very pleased to announce that the Abu Dhabi Global Market has proposed a regulation on spot crypto trading. So, you know, Twitter, LinkedIn, everything, please. That'd be great. So we have a consultation paper out now. Is to regulate the full suite of risks as we see them in the spot crypto markets. Okay, so essentially what we recognize is that there is a very large amount of participation in these markets and there is a whole bunch of risks there. So we're seeking to implement the right amount of oversight and transparency, making it a more credible market. And those, for example, institutions that saw far too much risk in the market, trying to help them through managing those risks by having a robust regulatory framework around it. Please do respond to our consultation paper. We would love to hear your comments. Please check out the website, etc.
But I actually want to acknowledge that that is a very much think local and the activity locally, but understanding the global perspective. You're one of the first to do anything in this space. Most regulators
Indeed.
Have shied away from crypto or have had policy that makes it somewhat illegal, and you're diving in feet first.
Yeah.
What makes this market so unique and so receptive to crypto?
It's really interesting, actually, because, well, first of all, as these conversations internally were progressing, I think a lot of regulators, and they, as I said, they see a lot of risk in the market. And as a regulator, when you say, I'm going to regulate that market, you instantly take on some risk yourself. Because it says that if I supervise it, we're going to make it safer. And if it's not safe, then it's kind of on you a little bit, right? So we decided that because there's so many people active in it, and because it is quite a unique market in some ways, if you look at the Japanese regulators, I think they were the first. Mm-hmm. Shortly after Mt. Gox in 2013, they started looking at it. And back then, it was more of a medium of exchange. So the Japanese regulators put it under their Payments Act. We look at it slightly differently. We acknowledge the risks as pertains to AML, consumer protection, technology governance. Mm-hmm. But these days, the participants in these markets behave like it acts almost like a security, an asset for investment purposes. And so some of the buckets of regulation we're looking at are custody, for example. Mm-hmm. How do you enforce appropriate custody over these assets so they are safe to be held on behalf of clients, and also market exchange type regulations, so market surveillance, mm-hmm. market manipulation controls, mm-hmm. trying to prevent insider trading. You know, these, and also things like clearing and settlement. How does that work? How do you make sure a trade is actually made? Now, so this is all in our consultation paper. Again, please respond. Please read and respond.
Well, that harks back to one of the earlier comments in the previous discussion around IP being the thing that actually will move the market, mm. or that will constitute the new asset class, and that that data, that information, whatever is mined in crypto, and that actually will become a secondary asset class that should be regulated as a security, precisely because I can speculate on the value of that information at a certain point in time. The first time we could actually buy futures on Bitcoin is quite an interesting thing. But this is, in my mind, this is actually really critical, because this is the way the market will be moving. Once we can tokenize information, we can watch its distribution, we can manage the risk around the movement, and we can actually speculate on its inherent value. And being one of the first markets to do that is really very forward thinking. Mm-hmm. I have to admit, I have not kept track of time, so is someone actually doing that for me? Excellent. Five? Perfect. Because what I would ask you now in terms of future, looking towards the future, what is the one thing you would like to see the GCC bring or adopt or do differently? Or even maybe double down on that you're currently doing?
Passport.
Give me the summation. All right.
So Europe has a passport between jurisdictions. Strikes me to make eminent sense to have a similar thing for GCC. I would love to have that.
So almost if we're going to look at it from a food perspective, how would you describe that?
Well, I guess it's sort of like calamari, right? Mm. It's on the menu in pretty much everyone kind of, some people like it, some people hate it, but it's kind of everywhere, and it's almost like a product you can move between countries, and you'll always find someone that likes it. Yeah, this is what calamari is like. And there are some startups who are very similar. You can move them in any given country, and there'll always be someone that likes it. So I guess startups are kind of like calamari, you know, but obviously, I mean, there are so many startups out there that, I mean, you might just find yourself with a Facebook calamari at one point. I mean, it's just way too much.
Just to clarify on the calamari comment, I do love these guys, okay? So I'm definitely on the love side, not the hate side in terms of calamari. But I agree, passport, you know, every single company or every single fintech expert I encounter all over the world, when we have a conversation about the Gulf, they say, you know, you guys need to take passport in more seriously. You need to open up the market as one. It's consistently the feedback that we get. It's a bit rich, really, isn't it? You've got three British guys, given the fallout from Brexit over the last couple of years, and probably the best example of this in the world is the EU. You know? So you've got three British guys saying how important passport is.
But I think the important point, that I think it was Chris made earlier, is that, you know, fintech businesses, we look at the ones that we're already regulating, we look at the ones that are in our, we've got our innovation testing license in our sandbox. It is, scalability is absolutely critical. None of our three markets are remotely big enough for fintech firms to get true scale unless, as a standalone company, unless they partner with a larger institution or sell their technology to several larger institutions. The scale there. But so whether it's by passporting or some other means, or whether it's by some evolution of the FCA's global sandbox idea, there needs to be a way where scale is more readily available to innovators, or the possibility of scale is more readily available.
If I could add a second point to passporting, I'd like to see the Gulf region become the pioneers. You know, with the drop in oil price, the diversification away from oil, a move much more towards entrepreneurship, innovation, technology at last, not just fintech. You know, instead of playing catch up with London or Singapore or looking to China or the United States, you know, maybe this region in 5 years' time will be the, you know, the benchmark by which some of those countries are looking at good practice. Again, going back to my recent visit to London, I know they're trying to get to grips with the open banking agenda at the moment. Mm. Something like that, I think, would be much easier to execute in Bahrain than in a much bigger economy like the UK. So, why can't the Gulf start to become, the Gulf states become the pioneers? Moving forward, whereas at the moment I feel as though we're playing a little bit of catch up with other world leading locations.
I do think the region is in a perfect primed position to leapfrog all of the mistakes that some of the earliest adopters have made. And if we're looking at an open banking platform, that like a calamari has tentacles everywhere.
Agreed.
I hate to indulge in personal jokes, but it's a personal joke and it's fun. Catch me later for the insight. It's an interesting place to be, where you have the notion of we're small but we're mighty, we're better together, collaboration makes sense. If passporting is a possibility, why wouldn't you do it? Clear the way to make that happen. And providing an opportunity to extend a market, or extend the opening of a market to those firms that are actually seeking to be here. I think what's really interesting is those technology companies that have come up and are trying to scale, they're looking for new markets. They're fundamentally looking for new markets. And the more open and inviting, the more access to regulation and policy influencers, that distinct conversation, that informal conversation that can very quickly happen, and a sandbox where they can prove and test within the market, fundamentally gives you an advantage to inviting those players into the market and allowing them to scale it, but also to find the massive efficiencies that come with inviting them into the market. Gentlemen, I want to thank you all, Chris, David, Peter, and thank you for your insights. I am going to offer them up as victims for questions. You know what they look like. Do we have time for one question? Ah, we might do. Let's start over here real quickly. You, sir. Or, yeah. You will need to move. You'll need to move.
I got a hustle, right? There we go. The exercise program.
All right, hello. Sorry to disappoint, it's not a question, it's a sincere feedback to the three institutions represented
here. Okay, I am going to cut you off because this is question only, you can give direct
feedback. Then I have a question. Can you please just keep doing what you are doing? We are under ADGM regulatory lab. We got introduced to Kenya Central Bank, to Bahrain Central Bank. Our team is currently in Oman, talking to the central bank. It just works. So sincere feedback from the ground, and thank you specifically to ADGM guys. Awesome work.
One exception, he made the comment, despite promising a question, I'm coming after you. Who's the next one? Seriously. Although, kudos to you guys.
As an ex-banker, I really like calamari and squid, so it's the right conversation. No, I just would like you to expand on the news that you just gave about what's happening in Abu Dhabi. I understand it's regulatory and possibly a new market. Could you give me a bit more information on that?
Yeah. So in terms of our proposed regulation for crypto asset markets, this proposed regulation is intended to cover what people commonly refer to as virtual currencies, so the Bitcoins of this world. Regulators cannot ignore this market anymore, right? It is way too active. There's too much money at risk. We've already seen billions of dollars lost as a result of this market across the globe. It is about time that regulators got involved, and they get involved in a very robust and rigorous way. Our proposed regulatory framework sets an extremely high bar for people wishing to operate crypto asset activities in the ADGM. We do see some nascent interest from institutions, traditional financial institutions, but they warn us that they cannot possibly get involved because it is totally unregulated. So by regulating it, you bring safety and oversight and transparency to these markets so that they can mature in a safe and responsible way.
And we white papers out. We have time. Oh, yes, right here.
A lot of people or a lot of banks in the world like are having a lot of bank APIs, but in this region, I think only two or three banks only have banking APIs in general. Is there any role that, as regulators, you are working with the finance institutions to actually enforce having banking APIs? And if there are any activity there, if you just can elaborate on what's happening in that field.
So something similar to PSD2 in Europe.
Yeah. Well, so the open banking component. For those of you who aren't familiar with PSD2, it really does enforce a certain element of competition. It opens the entire tech stack to third parties, specifically around payments. Those third parties now have direct access to the account information, which means there needs to be a conversation point between the bank and the third party and the customer. There are much more rigorous validation, authorization, and authentication requirements, and there are actually technical standards, 9 of which were issued in January for the UK specifically, as the UK was the first to move into the technical requirements for practical open banking. The EU will be enforcing that later this year. Banks have been a little bit slow to open the tech stack, but what it does is it allows for a third party to play a microservice, at least in the payments. However, what this also does from a banking advantage point is allows the bank to then take on best of breed services for data consumption, also for transaction initiation, and they still maintain the account, but they are also then able to start to compete with these third parties and up their services or still maintain the entire relationship. It fundamentally opens up the tech stack. It's supposed to encourage competition, but what it now allows us from a delivery perspective to do is find the simplest, cleanest, most effective, and data insightful workflow for any particular transaction. I think that's been the most interesting and engaging thing about banking in the last X number of years is the API structure. It also means that you can play the Lego set and compose something that is fundamentally interesting and value added rather than a traditional stack. Yes.
I think the rationale in this region, and what I'd like to hear from one of you guys, what you think and if it applies in this region, is the banks haven't necessarily gone after SMEs. They haven't gone after lower income populations. They haven't gone after a number of different financial transactions that may not be as profitable as, you know, you're kind of where they're at today. So do you think from a regulatory standpoint, that's something that you should be looking at and considering, or do you think that it's just let the market play out?
I think the answer is absolutely yes. Regulators should play a more active role in addressing some of these problems in the market. So we have an SME theme to our third cohort of the Reg Lab, which is open on the 10th of May. And we are trying to encourage banks to look at more slightly, well, they're trying to encourage them to look more cleverly at the SME sector. Are there different data sets they can use? Are there different tools they can use to promote financial services into the SME sector? You know, we work with currently 16 firms who are members of our Reg Lab. And to go back to the API conversation and the question over there, yes, fundamentally API standards are remarkably important because as a technology company, it effectively allows you to port your solution between different institutions really, really easily. And yes, absolutely, there is definitely a role for the regulator to play. It's something we're looking into in terms of convening the institutions around actually standards which may help much more efficient integration of different technology solutions.
I think in the UAE context, the government role is obviously important as well. Many of you will be aware there's a Dubai data law, which is about sharing Dubai government information, of which we're a part. And we're still trying to work out what the information is that we need to share with or make available. And it's obviously a natural progression from that to then expand beyond the public sector and look at what else and who else should be sharing data. So I tend to agree with Chris, there's a role for regulators in this, but I think particularly in this part of the world with sensitivities around sharing information and so on, I think there's an important role for governments as well.
So our next conversation will be around privacy tech, which wave of the future. And on that particular note, thank you for your questions. You know what these gentlemen look like. I give you free permission to attack them during lunch and inquisition them. But my gratitude to all of you gentlemen, Peter, David, and Chris, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is that calamari for lunch?
Are we serving calamari for lunch, by the way?
Thanks, everyone. Lunch is outside. If I'd brought my sheet up here, I could tell you when we're going to start again. Serene, what time are we starting again? We're starting again at what time? At 1:45. So please go enjoy your lunch. Come on back. We've got Ripple, blockchain, AI, a whole bunch of interesting conversations, banks of the future this afternoon. So thanks a lot.